Welcome back to my channel. It's your girl Nats, and I hope everyone is happy, healthy, and doing okay. In today's video, I will be talking to you guys about ways in which you can survive in Japan as a foreigner and a Jamaican. I mean, a Jamaican is a foreigner in Japan, but foreigners in general. But maybe I'll have a few tips for my Jamaican yardie fam specifically. Alright, so that is what we'll be talking about today. So if you want to know tips on how you can survive as a foreigner in Japan, then keep on watching. Guys, before we head into today's video, of course we have some shout outs to do. So let me grab my shout out box because I changed the bag and get someone shouted out, okay? Alright, so let's see who is getting shout out today. Alright, I have a paper. Oh my god, I rolled these up so much. Alright, so this week's Natsnificent shout out goes to Timmy Gabby. And the comment was, moving to Japan in a few months and your videos have taught me a lot. I'm super excited to venture on this new journey. I got you, okay? I got you. And this comment was left on my Day in the Life video. If you haven't seen it, I will link it right here for you guys to go and watch, of course, after you finished watching this one. So Timmy Gabby, thank you for watching my video and leaving a comment. All right guys, back to the video. Beam. Okay, so the first tip that I have for you on how you can survive in Japan as a foreigner is to join Facebook groups. And I know that might sound silly to some persons, but guys, actually Facebook groups help. It helps your mental stability. All right, when I just got here, I did not know actually that there were Jamaican in Japan groups and so on Facebook that could provide moral support, emotional support, or you know, just a sense of community, some people that you can talk to whenever, you know, being in a foreign country is just too much. So I do recommend like going into Facebook groups for your specific country. So if you're a Filipino, search up Filipinos in Japan, Jamaicans in Japan, Americans in Japan, Africans in Japan, like wherever you're from, Colombians in Japan. I'm not sure if any Spanish people are watching this, but I mean, just search for groups that, you know, is related to your country and try to find communities. Use hashtags, search for hashtags. I remember when I just started searching for Jamaican food, I would always search the hashtag Jamaicans in Japan just to see if any other Jamaicans are here cooking Jamaican food so that I could see their caption, read it, and try to figure out where they're getting their stuff. It's a whole piece of work, but it is very helpful. And now I am a part of the Jamaican in Japan Facebook group. Right now we're doing a thing called Dash Out Sunday, where every Sunday all the yardie people in the group just post up the Sunday dinner. And you know, it's just a sense of home away from home. People that you can actually go out with, meet up with, and socialize with away from home. So I do recommend joining groups. Okay, the second tip that I have for you on how you can survive as a foreigner in Japan is to budget shipping supplies. And what I mean by this is put it in your budget to get supplies shipped to you. But only if you are a person who is somewhat attached to your country and you need things from your country to survive. And case in example, me. I'm a Jamaican, as I've said many times, and a very good part of my life is eating Western food, you know, like well-seasoned food. I mean, no shame to Japan, but the food here tastes very different from what I'm used to. So I budget shipping supplies to me, supplies that I need, so seasonings to cook, alcohol from Jamaica, because trust me, the green alcohol in Jamaica is so strong. And I'm not talking like alcohol that you drink, like rubbing alcohol, okay? It's stronger than the one that I've experienced here in Japan. So I get some of that. I get medicine, like flu medicine, because to be honest, guys, the medicine here is weak. It doesn't do anything. Like, the strongest meds that I've taken is Buferin, and Buferin is like a worldwide thing. It's not new at all. So yeah, like, if you are a person that will need stuff like hair care products, makeup, all of those stuff, food stuff, snacks that you know that you'll miss and you love, then try to budget sending those supplies to you before you actually leave your home country, if it is that you know your address. But if you don't know your address, when you get to Japan and you're settled in, then you can ask family members and friends to, you know, ship some stuff to you. As for me right now, we do that like every 3 months or so, maybe more, depending on how long the season, the supplies last. Normally, it depends on when my seasonings are at the low. That's when I will call for a care package in Jamaica. So be mindful of that. If you're going to be needing stuff, then definitely think about budgeting, shipping those supplies to you in care packages. All right, the third tip on how to survive in Japan as a foreigner is get Google Translator on your phone. It is a lifesaver when you live in a foreign country that you have no idea of the language. And even if you do have an idea of the language, sometimes it is very like difficult to like get points across and so on and so forth. So I recommend getting Google Translate. I mean, I don't have to expound on this too much, because we all know what a translating app does. And it helps. It helps. If you go to the supermarket and you're looking for a specific thing, and you have been walking in the supermarket for 10, 15 minutes and you cannot find what you're looking for, then you can always just talk into the translating app, or you can write into the translating app and just show it to one of the store clerks, and you know, they'll understand because it's in Japanese, and they could just lead you to it. Because once you pop out the phone with the translator, then they know that you don't know Japanese, and so they'll just bring you to the aisle where you can find whatever you're looking for. And that's just an example, right, without speaking. And if you go like, so if you go to the post office and you need to just do something quick, like, where do I drop this? Where do I mail this or something like that? It's very easy to use translator to do stuff like this. If you want to do something like more technical, like, you know, something that will require more Japanese ability, like going to the doctor or so on, then you may need to either get some form of a Japanese friend that can also speak English. Or normally the dispatch companies, they have coordinators. Well, you know what? I'm speaking for my dispatch company. They have coordinators in every single city that they have employees, meaning ALTs, for support. So if I get sick and I need to go to the doctor right now, I can just go on my phone, contact my coordinator, and they will take me to the doctor. Of course, the disadvantage with that is that the company knows your business. People know your business, and you might not necessarily want that. But if you don't speak the language, what you gonna do, huh? You gotta just do it. So that is my recommendation. Get the translating app. The next tip that I have for you on how to survive in Japan as a foreigner is to learn the basic phrases in Japanese. And I know you might be saying, girl, you said many times you don't speak Japanese, you don't understand Japanese. Yes, I don't. But guess what? I actually know the simple phrases in Japanese. I know how to say good morning. I know how to say good afternoon. I know how to say excuse me. I know how to ask where can I find the toilet. I know how to ask how are you. I know basic simple stuff that can get me around. You know, where is the bus stop? Where is the taxi? Do you have whatever? Like, I know how to say those stuff, and that is why I say I'm not aiming to be fluent in Japanese, but I know enough to like get me around and like talk to people. And if I cannot talk to them, then I use my translator. But Adam, he was studying Japanese for a few months, and he actually knows way more than I do. Adam can actually be on the phone with a Japanese person, like rescheduling. I've heard him rescheduling a delivery. Like when you order online, you miss the delivery, and the person is talking in Japanese, and he's like, he understood because he was responding in Japanese. I'm like, you go, babe. You know, he's better. Listen, I'm not at the age where I want to learn anymore. Like, learning is difficult. Like, I cannot. I spent too many years at school. I'm done. All right, but Adam, he loves learning. He loves school. He loves all of that stuff. So, he learns on our behalf. All right, so learn basic phrase in Japanese. Imagine you just touch off the plane, right? Fresh in Japan. And a Japanese person says, good day, how may I help you, or how are you? And you can't answer. Like, that is kind of like no efforts being put into place to at least learn how to say hello in Japanese to a Japanese person coming into their country. Not saying that they're thinking like that, but just my opinion, right? So I would say learn simple phrases. By the way, guys, comment below if you'd want me to do a video where I teach you the simple phrases that I know. Not every single simple phrase that you need to know in order to move here, but actually what I know. All right, and maybe I'll invite Adam over so he can give you a more sentence structure kind of Japanese. But I can teach you like simple words in Japanese if you would like that. So comment below if you would want that. All right, so the next tip on how to survive in Japan as a foreigner is bring all your documents to Japan. Guys, listen, it does not matter if you think you are never going to use them. Bring them. Bring your CXC results. Bring your degree. Bring your birth certificate. Bring your TRN. Bring your social security number. Bring your home country ID. Bring your passport. Of course, I need a passport to travel, duh. Bring every single thing. You understand me? Because you never, like, life is so funny. Like, you will go years without using a particular document, and then you're like, yeah, I'm never gonna use it. I haven't used that document in 5 years. And then all of a sudden you pop into a new country, and guess what you need? That old document from that you haven't used from 5 years ago. So I say bring everything. As a matter of fact, I have my CXC results here with me in Japan. There is no way that I think that I'm going to need my CXC results, but guess what? If anything comes up, if this life gets crazy and for some reason somebody needs to prove that I have high school education, then they're in luck because I have it to show them. You understand? So guys, bring everything. As a matter of fact, just the other day I was in communication with my bank, because actually I did not tell my bank that I was leaving. And so, you know, many little conversations had to be had while I was here. And they wanted my ID, they wanted my TRN. And instead of having to call my mother and say, mommy, when you get home, you can search for this for me, search for that for me, and send me a picture of it, and all of that's just stressing out your family members, I had it on hand and I could just scan it and email it right away, no problem. So bring all your documents when you are leaving your home country, okay? Also, another tip in bringing your documents is to also leave a copy at home, just in case someone, like a family member, needs to run into a bank or something, like an actual person need to go for you, then at least they have a copy. So actually, my mother, you know, parents always keep your documents. As a matter of fact, I had to ask my mother for my birth certificate when I was moving here, because she has all of those things stored away. So I left a copy of everything there, except my degree, which is stupid. But what I'm saying is, it's much easier for me to scan and send to her email anyway than for her having to go through a lot of stuff. So bring your documents, guys. The seventh tip that I have for you on how to survive in Japan as a foreigner is, if you are one of the persons who want to drive in Japan, I suggest start doing your research from now. I do not have information that could be useful to you, or maybe what I know could be useful, but I do not have extensive information on driving in Japan, because I don't drive and Adam don't drive, neither do we plan to drive. So I don't have much information, but what I do know is that if you want to drive here, then you need an international driving permit from your home country, or I'm not sure how every other country goes. I'm speaking specifically for Jamaicans at this point. You have to get an international driver's permit from Jamaica before you can actually drive here. But that permit expires in 1 year. You only have 1 year to come over here and drive on that permit. So if you're a person like me who have been here for 2 years and maybe you plan to spend 3 or 4 or 5 years, then I mean, you get the permit, you'll only be able to drive for 1 year, because I think that's the expiry date on the permit, based on people that I know that have had it. It only lasts for a year. But otherwise, though, I think you can get your license translated into Japanese. I do not know the process about that. I do not know how it works. But I do know that some form of translating your Jamaican license or your home country license can be made into Japanese, where you can drive for as long as you are here. But in that case, you need to have your Jamaican driver's license for at least 3 months before actually coming into Japan. They need to prove that you have had your license for 3 straight months before leaving your home country for any form of long-term Japanese driver's license conversion. I hope that makes sense, because that is all the information I have for you, to be honest. I don't know anything else about the driving, guys. So do your research. If you are going to want to drive in Japan, do your research. Contact your driving depot in Jamaica. Maybe send some emails to your company. Ask your company how it works and so on and so forth. Just get information. All right? Get some information. The next tip, number 8. 8th way of surviving in Japan as a foreigner is, I talk with my hands a lot, don't I? Communicate with your family through the time difference, guys. It really helps. Communicating with your family is important. You done left them in your own home country, right? Right? Like, they need to be hearing from you. So in my case, Jamaica, Japan is 14 hours ahead of Jamaica, which means that right now at the time of recording this video, it's 10:50 a.m. Friday, May 22, and it is actually 10:09:08. Like, I can't do math, so I count backwards. 10:09, so it's 8:50 p.m. in Jamaica right now, Thursday night. So I am way ahead of Jamaica, but I do sacrifice the time. I find the time to communicate with my family and my friends and so on, just to keep a piece of you there, because they say out of sight, out of mind. But you can also play your part in ensuring that you are not out of mind, and that your mom or your parents are not missing hearing from you and so on. Keep in touch with your family, guys, and that should have been the first tip. Keep in touch with your family. They will offer me. There are a lot of times I'll call my mom, be like, "Mommy, I just want to leave Japan. I'm here on a saving goal." And some of the times, trust me, it's as if I want to pack up everything and just head back straight to my yard. You understand? And in times like those, my mom, my family is there to remind me of why I came here, all of that. So mental support, emotional support. Keep in touch with your family. All right? Yes. The next tip in how to survive in Japan as a foreigner is, know that you have to be patient when you come to Japan. All right, in terms of speaking and communicating, guys, remember, you are entering into an Asian country where the language is totally different. You're entering Japan. They speak Japanese. They don't speak English. Or some persons speak English. But the point I'm trying to make is, Japanese is their first language. English is not even their second language. But I think they're working on making English their second language, which surprisingly not enough people know English to even make that happen. But whatever, that's what they say. So communicating with persons can be difficult, especially if you don't have help. All right, so it is going to be very hard for you to go to your light bill company and complain about why your light bill is so much this month and it wasn't this much last month. It's going to be hard to like voice your complaints and all of that if you don't have support. So in my case, I have my coordinator, as I said before, that I could ask for stuff. and they will help me. But in other cases, you don't have that kind of support, it's going to be difficult to communicate. So you have to be patient. If you're going to somewhere and somebody speaks minimal English, just bear in mind that you'll have to maybe stand up at least 5-10 minutes while the other person goes through all the broken English that they know. And you'll have to just be patient in trying to figure out what they're trying to say. Be patient, because just as how you want them to understand that your first language is English and you don't really know Japanese that well or any at all, you need to understand that they don't understand or know English that well or at all. So be patient. All right. Example two, where I said my company helps me out a lot in terms of the coordinator. We moved from the countryside to the city, and in doing that, our Japanese phone, which is actually my next tip, but I'm telling you this story first. Our phones, we got them in the countryside in that area. And we needed to change our address and we needed to change our way of payment for our phone bill each month. And all of it was in Japanese. So we had to text our coordinator on Line. Line is another app similar to WhatsApp that Japanese use. And we had to text her and ask her to help us translate all the paperwork, the application form to change our address and change our payment. And we had to send her a picture, and she was first line, write this. Second line, circle this one and write your branch name here. So third line, circle this one and write these numbers. That is how we get help when everything is in Japanese. But otherwise, guys, if you don't have that kind of support, you will have to take your own little time with Google Translator and translate everything line for line, piece for piece, or ask somebody, ask a person, go into the actual phone store and ask somebody to help you. And it can take a while, all right? Because we have visited on our own to stores where we're trying to do something, even buying furniture for this new house. When we went to Nitori, there's a Japanese home furniture store, like IKEA in the US. We were ordering furniture and so on, and we needed to set delivery times. We needed to explain to them that yes, we want them to help us assemble some of the stuff and just all of that. And it took us maybe 45 minutes to get everything done. I mean, we were ordering a lot of stuff, but speaking to the representative and actually saying which day we want it delivered, what time, which color, because there's a language barrier, guys, but let me tell you something. They're ensuring that they're giving you top-notch service. Because even though you tell them that, yes, you want the black chair, when they're actually writing up the invoice, they will ask you, are you sure? These are the colors and you want the black chair, right? And you say, yes, ma'am, black chair. And they'll ask you, black chair, many times, just to be sure. So you have to be patient. That's really what I'm saying. And my last tip, my final tip, is to get a Japanese cell phone. And I know you need a Japanese cell phone, guys. I've been here 2 years, and for one straight year I didn't have a Japanese phone. And to be honest, I don't know how come I didn't. I don't know why I didn't. Adam also, he didn't have a Japanese phone for the entire first year that he was here, and I'm like, how did you even survive without it? But I guess Adam's company, I don't know. I don't know why Adam did not have a Japanese phone in the first year. I don't know how he survived a full year without the Japanese phone. But it has come in very handy for us. It is very easy to reschedule deliveries. It is very easy for your company to get in contact with you. It is easy for when you're filling out forms and they ask you for a contact number. It's easy when you can provide a number for them. It's easy, because having your home country SIM card in your phone, it's of no use to you, because unless you're roaming, and roaming is very expensive, you cannot make calls. So I have this phone and my Jamaican SIM card is in there, but I cannot make calls on it. So I only really right now use this phone for WhatsApp. And to be honest, I have a Japanese phone. my Japanese phone. This is my Japanese phone. And the only reason why I have two phones is just because this phone only uses one SIM card. And I do not want to get rid of my Jamaican number yet. Because as I said, I didn't tell much people when I was leaving for Japan. So a lot of things are centered around my Jamaican number. So I do not want to lose that yet. I don't know. Yeah, 2 years have passed and I haven't done anything about that. But the fact of the matter is I'm not ready to let go of my Jamaican number. So I still keep it in this phone. And then I get a Japanese phone with an actual Japanese number. This one is actually dead because I really don't pay it any mind unless I'm at school, because I use it for the internet. So I like Wi-Fi. I use hotspot on this phone when I am at school. But Adam actually has a phone that uses two SIM cards. This is a Galaxy S7. I know we're behind time. Adam has a Galaxy S7 Edge. That one uses two SIM cards. So he has his Jamaican SIM card and his Japanese SIM card in one phone, which is awesome. But I only can use one SIM card in this one. So I have to have a second phone. But I do recommend getting a phone, guys. All right, I have been talking a whole lot. I do hope that you find these tips helpful, and I wish you all the best in your transition to Japan. If you found these information useful, then give my video a big thumbs up. Don't forget to hit the notification bell to get notified every time I post a video. And of course, guys, please subscribe to my channel. All right, thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you in my next one. Bye, guys. So back to what I was saying.